Oh my gosh.
Well, hello and welcome to a session of Conversations with Pathologists. I'm Dr. Lewis Hassel, and with me today is Dr. Eric Glassy. Dr. Glassy has a lengthy history in pathology, almost as perhaps even longer than mine. And so he has a great perspective. He's noted for his fantastic dynamic presentations, but today we're going to do more direct conversational interaction so that you can both enjoy our faces without slides in the process. So Eric, tell me a little bit more, or tell the audience a little bit more about your background and pathology, what kind of job you're working in now at this point in your career.
All right. So, well, thank you, Lewis, for the opportunity first to chat with folks and share some of my experiences. I'm a community pathologist in Los Angeles in Southern California. I am in a large pathology group. We have 40 in our group, and we cover 21 service centers. And so that ranges as far north as we have a hospital up in Portland and one in Tillamook, a small emergency hospital. We have several in Northern California, a group in Southern California where I am, and then a bit farther south in Orange County area. And our group also covers at a LabCorp facility out in Phoenix. So we do all flavors of pathology. We have one hospital out of the whole group that is a for-profit. The rest are not-for-profit hospitals of varying sizes. Largest is probably 400 beds. And we have a number of smaller community hospitals that don't need everyday service. So we go out as needed for frozens and those kind of things. So it's really quite a mix, as well as the LabCorp outreach business that we do. We have five pathologists in Phoenix. So that's a broad overview of the group. I'm very proud of this group. It's called Affiliated Pathologist Medical Group. And we have a very flat organizational structure. We have, people are elected to the board, and there's seven people on the board, and they serve for 3 years. And we have a direct path to shareholder status. When this group was started, there's four of us that started this group. We had a couple of criteria. One was you had to retire at 65. That would prevent old people from clinging on for dear life, you know, even when they weren't particularly productive. And the second is to try and make it easy to attract really good people. So our goal has always been to bring folks in that could be medical directors as opportunities arise to grow organically. And we've done that. I've hit my retirement point, but I'm still working. The group has the option of hiring you back. So I'm very fortunate that I'm still worthy enough to be a continued employment with my path group. So that's sort of my day job. In terms of what I do specifically, I do general IT support, website support, those kind of things, marketing for our group. You know, Lewis knows I like to futz around with graphics and stuff. So that part's been enjoyable for me. And I predominantly right now do digital path and focusing on breast markers. We do image analysis and mismatch repair gene for our group, as well as for some other pathologists that are not part of our group. And we have a good reference lab that does anatomic only. And that's primarily where I am. I'm also medical director, co-medical director at a hospital in San Pedro, but most of the time I'm at the reference lab. So that's,
and yeah, lots so you, of projects. You came into your practice over that low threshold. And I suspect you started out doing a lot of general path, surge path, and clinical lab stuff. Yeah. And then over the course of your career, as your group has grown, as your service areas have grown, you've sort of differentiated into varying degrees of specialization and niche practice, so that now you're doing all this digital pathology reference lab kind of stuff within a private practice setting. That's really remarkable. Is that atypical, do you think? Or
Yeah, I think it, well, I think the size is unusual. I mean, there are larger groups, but not many larger community practice groups. Clearly at an academic center, 40 pathologists is not that big a deal, but in a community setting, particularly in California, that is unusual. And the fact that we're multi-state with a fair amount of distance between those is unusual. Yeah. And I think the flavor of pathology, in which we've done everything from in-office histology cases to for-profit, not-for-profit, joint ventures with physicians. I mean, it is pretty amazing. But back in I joined the group in 1981. And I was the fourth one added, mostly because the other guys wanted to take vacation, and I was there just to, as vacation coverage, more or less. And I was the first one to move out of the group to another hospital. And a pathologist friend wanted to retire and go part time. He needed someone to do tumor boards and the grossing and the usual things in a 150 bed hospital. It was close to where I lived, so that was an easy transition for me. And then he fully retired. I took over his directorship. And then since then, I've been a director at varying size facilities along the way. And I'm blessed because the group gives me a big sandbox to play in. I have lots of variety is really important to me. I can't do the same thing every single day, although COVID is a bit of a challenge because it is pretty much Groundhog Day, under COVID. But that aside, having an opportunity to do lots of different things has been important to me. And I've been able to embrace serendipity. Things just sort of show up, they happen. And if I've been lucky enough to be in the right place at the right time, including, befriending, some administrators who later on said, hey, let's get Glassy in here to do the directorship stuff. And that's been, my gosh, I'm very blessed, as you are, Lewis.
Well, yeah. So tell me about some of those challenges that sort of pop into your life that sort of drive you, that make you excited to get up and go to work.
Well, in the past, I've always liked presentations and doing graphic design and things. So that led me to work on the website for our group. I think it's a really good website with at least good graphic design. I was doing years ago when ASAP and CAP were together, I was doing some hematology lectures with my professor, head of Heme Path at Harvard UCLA Medical Center, where I did my residency. And her name is Nora Sun, and she asked me to do some educational conferences with ASCP. And one of these, the chair of the hematology and hematology resource committee was in the audience. And he said, hey, afterwards he said, Eric, I'm introducing myself. I'm Dr. Rabinovich. And I'd like to see if you'd be willing to join the heme committee. So I said, gosh, I was a CAP member, but I was never involved much. And that was pretty early in my career. So I said, sure. So I ended up going up to Toronto, he was Canadian. So a lot of the meetings were up in Canada. So we went up to Victoria in there, and we had our first meeting. And out of that experience of being on that committee, I got involved with putting a book together for the CAP, a hematology atlas based on proficiency testing. And that let me play around with graphic design and page layout and all that kind of stuff. And then I got on publications committee because I complained that there wasn't enough marketing done for these textbooks. And if you complain enough, they stick you on things to shut you up. But I really love being on the publications committee, and that allowed me to work on other projects, other publications. So that's been, again, serendipity. Somebody happened to be in the audience. It wasn't something I thought about. but it turned into a really great opportunity. I'm currently, we finished up the second edition of the Heme Atlas, and now we're, which was just peripheral blood, and now I'm working on the bone marrow volume 2 of that. And we've got some great cases in there. A lot of virtual bone marrow smears are available with QR codes that link up to your tablet or your phone to review those, you know, using digital scope. So, and I love, and we're filming authors. So we're doing like a Zoom of the different authors. So there'll be an opportunity within the book to link to talks that the different authors give, highlights of the chapter that they're giving. So it's a bit of, it involves multimedia. I mean, that's, I mean, again, that's all serendipity, just very lucky to be in a position where I could take advantage of the variety and the skill sets that I, you know, that I think of as hobbies, but you can turn those hobbies into something productive in your practice. So that's probably the biggest, you know, change, at least, or opportunities. I've had many within the CAP itself, in terms of being on some great committees, opportunity to meet some phenomenal individuals within the CAP. You know, Gene Herbeck died recently, and he was a good friend, and others, Paul Bochner. I mean, there's many folks you can name that you say those folks are really outstanding and role models for our profession. And I had a chance to work with them and continue to work with Paul Bochner on some projects. So I'm what can I say? I have the support of family.
I can say that I think you're impacting the profession in a very natural but a very profound way in terms of, you know, some, not just the publications, but the connectivity, the integration of you know, digital tools with, you know, archives or with your publications.
I mean,
this is a great example of how a fertile mind and opportunity becomes much more likely to happen. There's this synergy that happens in exciting ways, and that's very fulfilling in your career and in your life to have those sorts of things. So you haven't retired at 65, and I assume that's because you're having fun.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So you said, you know, what motivates me to get up in the morning? It's because I've got some, you know, another project to work on. I've got 2 talks to give, so I've been working on those. Maybe I'll share a little tail end of something at the end of this, because I think it's an important message to give the pathologist during COVID. But so those are good. I'm on the Board of Governors, so that for another couple of years. So that's been a good opportunity. And then on American Board of Pathology, you know, writing questions and being involved with the CertLink program and seeing the value of continuous learning and interaction with our younger colleagues. Yeah, all that part's good stuff.
Well, as you think about your experiences in this, and I think you probably answered this question already, what to you are the things that make you feel most worthwhile or most pleased in your work? What are those aha that was it moments for you?
You know, sometimes they're small. I mean, I like giving talks, and some people have a very methodical way of putting a talk together. They'll do an outline, and then they'll get the graphic pieces that put together, or they follow the template in PowerPoint, or I'm an Apple guy, so I use Keynote. But you know, I'd like the creative side of stuff. So for me, a talk doesn't come together until I find a really strong opening or a strong ending. And I sort of wallow around in the talk. I have a general idea of what I want to say, but until I get inspired by a focal point within the talk, that's a video, a piece I put together, or something that I think is going to grab the attention of the audience. Once I get that piece over that hump, then all the rest of it sort of comes together. I build on that one or two areas in the talk that I think are strong points, and then it makes it easier for me to talk. Until I get those strong pieces of visual interest, I'm just, it's not a good presentation for me. So I'm always thinking about if I'm sitting in the audience, what do I want to see? You know, and I want to be entertained, of course. I don't want to have boring stuff, but I also want, I want to come away with something that is new to me, or something that was a surprise, and trying to build that in. And always a call to action, right? At the end of a good talk, there should be a stated call to action. Maybe it's subtle, but you want people to leave saying, hey, I'm going to become more professional because of this. I'm going to embrace this or that technology, digital path, or some other opportunity within pathology. Those, I think, are the most, not all my talks have been like that, but I have a few that I'm proud of that really did have a call to action. And now I'm focused more on the younger, new in practice, right? You get old in your group, you're the senior guy, a founding father, and you want the younger folks coming in to say, hey, you know, you want your legacy to continue, right? And so that transition from older to younger, honestly, is a challenge. The older guys in the group that started it have spent a lot of time thinking about how we would, how best to bring in young new talent. It's always a challenge, and to be as fair as possible. Yeah.
Well, let's move back a generation and just think about those who are making their specialty choice this year, you know, deciding whether they should match into surgery or pathology or radiology or something. What would you say to those people about your decision and about their decision that's coming up?
Well, I'd say first, don't believe student doc.net, you know, the stuff. There's some great stuff on social media, but studentdoctor.net is not where you get all the information about different subspecialties, particularly pathology and radiology. So there's a lot of negative posts about, don't go into pathology because AI is going to take your job, or radiology, the same thing. And what I found is that AI, machine learning, is now a whole new area to explore within pathology, a whole new opportunity, and that should bring the brightest and the smartest. Think about pathology as a profession. Where can you do computational pathology? You could do direct patient care. You know, you could find needle aspiration of bone marrows and interact in a coag lab. You can do research. You can have a PhD focus. You can do teaching. You have a whole, and plus day-to-day work, you have a whole list of things in pathology that others can't do. I know the government's always talking about, you know, we want to put more money into primary care, you know, because that's direct patient focus. But think of the pathologist. We are touching more people than primary care folks do.
Oh, by
the
far.
Lab.
Yeah, by far.
By far. And if you want to have the strongest and best impact on people throughout healthcare, pathology is the way to do it. Of course, you could stay in your office and be the mushroom and never come out, and that's wasting your talent and not communicating. You're living the stereotype, not what you should be doing as a pathologist. So here's an opportunity, I think, for younger folks to say, hey, I have all these choices. Go into path, and then you can focus in on multiple opportunities that you can, if you decide, hey, I'm just doing cardiology, or I'm just going to do, family practice. For me, I started off thinking of going into, internal medicine. Actually, I was signed up for internal medicine internship back east, and I was out in California and at UC San Francisco, and I had to do a couple electives. And so toward the end of my last year, my fourth year, I signed up for cytology, and I met some very extraordinarily powerful individuals in a positive way that got me inspired to go into path. And one was Eileen King, and the folk that were all, that was when fine needle aspirations were starting here. You could touch a patient. You could sample the lymph node or the salivary gland or the mass, the breast mass, and then you could get an answer right away. And I thought, wow, how impactful is that? So I switched, you know, I moved from, you know, canceled the internship.
Saved at the last minute.
that was close, and went into pathology.
Yeah. Well, Eric,
and I have to, yeah.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
I was going to say, and that is, and I have to put an asterisk to all that. Because people say, well, did you have other influences? You know, my dad was a pathologist. And people say, oh, that's obviously why you did it. But my dad was, he was a great guy, and he never brought his work home. So to be honest, I didn't know what it was like to be a pathologist. I didn't. I know he was happy with what he was doing. He had particular areas of interest, but he didn't bring the problems, the issues. He was in a two-person practice in Wisconsin. And so I didn't realize what it was until later. And I had this revelation at UC San Francisco, and I talked to him and I got mad at him. I said, how come you never told me all these good things about it? And he said, well, I just didn't want to influence you, but I'm delighted that you made the right choice, just like you said there, Lewis. So we all have our little stories and stuff. But I'm proud of the opportunity to be a pathologist. Definitely.
Well, this has been really wonderful, Eric. I appreciate that your path is very parallel to many others, to mine and so forth, that sometimes we didn't start out heading towards pathology, but we find our way there, whether it's through after an internship in something else or directly in fourth year of medical school or wherever. And when you get here, you discover that there's a lot of really interesting things to do in this field, and that you can, as life goes on, You just are like a kid in the sandbox. You know, what do I play with next? It's fun. And so.
So many children.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate your time today, Eric. This has been wonderful. And I think it will be very helpful to our students and residents as they think about career choices and options for practice and so forth going forward. And, if we have any links to some of your resources, we might put those in the comments or in the details under the video. So that people can see some of the creative work that you've done. So any last words you want to say before we wrap up?
No, could I just show you the last, I just started, there's only about six
oh, yes,
small slides.
Please.
Can let I me, share the screen?
Yeah, let me make sure you can share here. Yes, go right ahead.
Okay, so let me do share screen. And I just want to, because I think this part's appropriate. Can you see okay?
Yeah.
All right, remote testing. Let me start it up here. And with COVID, I've been doing a lot of digital path remote sign out of cases, predominantly breast markers and such, right?
Yeah.
But I wanted to make this point about don't be remote when you are remote. What do I mean by that? It's like, you know, pathologists are the geeks of medicine. Often we're considered, the folks that usually have the biggest library. If you want, before there was Google, there was pathologists, right? This is where clinicians came for their answers. And we're really experts at seeing things, but we're not experts at being seen. You know, we're often quiet, or many of us are introverted and don't want to be the ones sitting in the doctor's lounge. So if you look up the word remote, there's two types of remotes. There's far away, distant, isolated, introspective, and secluded, you know, something like remote sign out. But then there's the other that's not the good side of remote, detached, uncommunicative, unconnected, and being aloof. So when you're doing digital pathology, now that we have a waiver from CMS and people can do their remote sign outs, their primary diagnosis from home, my plea is for pathologists to pick up the phone and connect with their clinicians. They need to interact with them and let them know that pathology, even though you're not in the office, you're there supporting them from a distance, from remote. So always keep that touch there, you know, and a phone call, whatever is important. And my last comment is, when that mask finally comes off and these groups of clinicians get together, who's missing? Well, be sure it's not you, right? Don't use COVID as an excuse not to engage. Pathologists are sort of naturally socially distancers, where many of us are uncomfortable being in social situations easily. We do have a number of folks that are more introverted, but don't allow COVID to be an excuse for not coming together and interacting. And so I'm looking for pathologists to kind of go past that and to trans be transformational, right? Become more dynamic, engaged, and participate on the clinical team, and so be part of that table once those masks come down. So these are tough times, and these are difficult situations. And to me, the best thing we can do is to stay engaged with our colleagues and continually prove our worth. So I'll send you those references and stuff. I love this quote too. Sometimes you find yourself in the middle of chaos, and sometimes in the middle of chaos, you find yourself. And I think that's very true. We're in the middle of chaos right now with COVID and pandemic and wild accusations, this or that. And the folks that can be the bringers of truth are definitely the pathologists. Anyway, that's a little clip of what I'm going to do for a spiel for Leica down the line. And I'll stop sharing here.
Well, Eric, you hit the nail on the head. You hit the nail on the head. You hit the ball out of the park. Whatever, you know, whatever aphorism you want to apply to it here, but I think your words of wisdom are very, very apropos and timely, and I hope that our audience will appreciate them. Thank you again for taking the time with me.
Thanks, Lewis.